In years past, trappers, prospectors, and explorers, as well as the native population in the far north, have had to endure the irritating and often painful ordeal of the biting flies. During the height of summer, these insects swarm in hundreds per square foot. Mining projects are bringing more and more people to the Canadian Arctic. The Department of Defense is also being more active there. Among the many species of biting insects, three kinds are of primary concern: the mosquito, the black fly, and the tabanid. The mosquito lays its eggs in stagnant waters where the larvae find suitable organic matter for food. The common species breathes by means of a tubular organ which is thrust through the surface. The larva pupates after about 2 weeks, but the pupa, though active, does not feed. When the mosquito is about to emerge, the pupa floats to the surface to shed its coat. The transformation is then a continuous and fairly rapid process. Usually, there is a short lapse after emergence, during which time the adult rests on the water or on a twig. The adult mates soon after it becomes active. The life of the mosquito may be a few days or a few weeks, depending on the species and the hazards it encounters. Unlike the mosquito, the black fly breeds in flowing waters, rapids, rivers, or streams. It lays its eggs underwater on stone or vegetation. The larvae feed on the organic matter in the water soon after hatching. When full grown, the larva spins a cocoon in which it pupates and remains until the fly emerges. The bite of the black fly is often painless when inflicted, but the poison injected may later cause swellings that are sore and itchy for days. The tabanid species, which includes the horsefly and the deer fly, breeds on the edge of bogs, ponds, and streams. The eggs are laid in clusters on leaves, close to or overhanging the water. They hatch after about 2 weeks, and the larvae burrow into the mud, where they feed on other insects as well as organic matter. Larvae may be found embedded on the edge of bogs. Otherwise, they are not seen until they emerge as full-grown flies. Tabanids do not draw the blood from their host. They make an incision and lap it up from the pool that forms. As far back as 1947, the Department of Agriculture, in cooperation with the Defense Research Board, initiated on-the-spot research and set up experimental stations near the insect habitats. One of the tests was to determine abundance and activity under various conditions. For mosquitoes, the test is made on the forearm, which is rubbed for 1 minute to increase attractiveness to insects. Then a record is made of the numbers landing and biting. In studying feeding habits, it was found that only the female fly feeds on blood. The male feeds on the nectar of wildflowers. Also, it is known that meteorological conditions have a bearing on biting flies' activity. Research and experiments have made considerable progress with repellents, as a result of which effective ones are now available. Much of the biological and chemical research has been directed to the use of insecticides, both in their composition and methods of application. Larviciding of mosquito breeding grounds can be done effectively with portable compressed air sprayers. A solution of DDT in fuel oil is commonly used. Where large areas are concerned, various kinds of equipment exist that can be mounted on vehicles. There is a fog-producing type, which sprays minute particles of insecticide that can drift long distances in the wind. Numerous tests are needed to determine the effectiveness of sprays in adulticide work over varying distances and under varying conditions, both in wooded and open country. For large-scale control operations over rough and marshy areas, the airplane comes to the rescue. The results of the investigation have been so promising as to give high hopes for some measure of control in the future.